Ladies and gentlemen, once again, a very warm welcome to the Reinvention Laboratory. I'm Corinna Egra, your host in this Reinvention Laboratory week. Great to have you back here. It's the last session of our day already. And yeah, as I said before, it's not going to be only theory, but also some fun with this. It's on virtual reality and it's used in standardization practice. And well, I think it's a technology that has evolved from a very special case to a mass application now. And I think we look forward to a very interesting session. So let me introduce you to Carsten Hunger, who is now going to be the host during this session. Carsten, the floor is yours. You are standardization manager at DKE German National Committee, responsible for the German Mirror Committees for electrical equipment and systems for railways and lightning protection. And furthermore, you're head of VDE, German Electrotechnical Association Competence Center, Smart Cities, and you organize the German Mirror Committees for this topic. And last but not least, you're the project leader of the TC of the Future booth that is right out here this hall during this entire week. Carsten, now the floor is yours, and I'm really excited to see what it's all about.
Thank you, Corinna. Thanks a lot. Ladies and gentlemen, also a warm welcome from my side. Thanks, Corinna, for introducing me. My name is Carsten Hunger, and today we are going into another reality. We are going to the virtual reality. I think nearly everybody of you has seen some movies, TV productions about this now, and mostly about the gaming sector. Everybody who thinks about virtual reality thinks, okay, maybe this is just a gadget for such the youth, and they can play games with it and so on. But today we will show you that this is not the only thing what you can do with this. As Corinna already said, this technology is now from a really special case going into a mass product. So the prices are falling and so on. And especially the game, we are happy to have the gaming sector because of that, it's going to be a mass product. So, and the prices are going like that. Our main topic for today, and also for just to introduce it to you, don't be afraid of that virtual reality. Sometimes some people say, well, I'm a bit afraid, I've heard a lot of this, but I'm not sure that this will be something for us. But we will show you today how this really can work, also in our standardization life, and how we can use it in the future. This will not happen tomorrow, but maybe in the future, in 1 or 2 or 5 years, maybe it's the same then that you sit in your on your couch at home and you have your virtual glasses on, and that's no deal. So, yeah. First of all, let's start with our first speaker, Mr. Markus Prenais. Come to the stage.
Hello.
Mr. Prenais is founder and CBO of Present4D, a virtual reality consulting company. And let me add, he's a virtual reality fanatic. So, yeah. Markus,
that's right.
The floor is yours.
Okay. So, okay, opportunities for virtual reality in the future. I would like to talk about three things. First, fields of application for virtual reality, data types in virtual reality, to give you an idea which opportunities arises from this new technique, and tracking types. So, first, let's explain virtual reality. You know, 100 years ago, when the cinema was invented, the screen was 10 or 20 meters away. Television comes to 3 to 5 meters, computers 1 meter 20, laptop 80 centimeter, smartphone 40 centimeter, and now we have the screen 30 millimeter in front of our eyes. You can't see sharp in the distance of 30 millimeters, so we have two lenses. And in here, there is a kind of a 5-inch display. And when I put on the goggles, then I see only that what is displayed on my display. And when I turn the head, then I also rotate in the virtual reality. The core feeling of virtual reality is a presence feeling. So it's unbelievable. You have to test it. You have to try it on your own later at our booth or later here in this session. It's really a strong feeling as if you were there. So I just want to show different media types and different fields of application. I will do this by demonstrating it directly under the glasses. See you later. I don't know if it is maybe it is that okay, there it is. Aha, I have to switch off PowerPoint. Okay. Okay, so if I come near to interactive buttons, then a crosshair cursor occurs. If I go with the cursor on the button, a circle is built up, and when the circle is finished, it's like a mouse click. And if I turn my head, then I turn my head also in the virtual reality. It's a strange feeling when I look down because I don't see my own body, and we are used to see our body in our field of view all the time, so it's a little bit freaky. I have the possibility to start slideshows, and they are much more impressive than you can see it at the moment because they are stereoscopic. That means each eye has its own picture, and I have a very deep feeling. I can also integrate a video, and I have such circles. When I look at the circles called hotspot, then I jump to the next location. This is a panorama menu, so we can make a panorama by photographing it, we can make it with computer animation, and we can build with Photoshop or similar software, we can build panorama menus. You see, this is the presentation, so instead of PowerPoint, what if future scenarios? We've already seen at the first panorama that the tourism can use 360-degree panorama imaging to show holiday destinations. Oops. Back to overview, there is next. So here I'm in Egypt. So for you, is it another boring picture in a frame, in a very little frame? For me, is it my actual whole world? I don't see anything different. When I'm looking to the sun, I can play with the lens flare. And from Egypt, where it's very dry, we can jump on a ship. And here we also have the possibility to look from above. Here we have the next media type. This is panorama video. Panorama video means no matter where I'm looking at, everywhere is movement. This means that we have new rules for producing audiovisual productions. Because the user himself decides where he looks at and how long he looks. New possibilities. So if I jump to the next location, then we have a next field of application. We have one example in the T-Mobile store, telecommunication. I can here try different telephones. So with the movement of my head, I can rotate the smartphone and can select which one I'd like to buy. So we've made a little trailer for a telecom project. So imagine we are at the store and we have the possibility to choose from different models. And from a specific point on, we can say infos about this smartphone, and I could now call someone who could bring me this model in real life. Okay, next scenario is industry. Here we are in Scandinavia, and this is a ship which has which transports ore, and the animation is made for ThyssenKrupp. ThyssenKrupp uses this example as extension for the handbook, for maintenance, and for trade fairs. Here we are in a power plant. It's a brown coal power plant, and this is the main part. Here is a turbine. But unfortunately, you can't see the turbine, but we, from Present 4D, we can jump in time. That's why we have the 4D in our name. I'm at the same place, but I jumped back half a year. And now I can explain much better how the turbine functions. And I can go very close. It's really impressive to see it from here. Next scenario is an event scenario. So this company, SMS, makes big machines for steel production. From here, I can go. So, okay. Let's have a look. Event. Okay, so far we have seen two media types which we can use, panorama photo and panorama video. But that's not all. You can also, so we can also start an example. So we have seen two different data types. Now we experience a third data type, real-time 3D. Real-time 3D has another dimension. You've seen that by rotation of the head, I can direct the panorama, I can look around. But in this case, not only the rotation of the head is tracked, now I've got an additional camera. And with this camera, it's possible for me to walk in the scene. So you see, I can walk in reality, and the amount I'm walking in reality is translated into the virtual reality. It's too dangerous to do it here with this cable. So I have an Xbox controller, and I have the trade fair from ThyssenKrupp at the Bauma this year. And in virtual reality, you have no borders, no physical borders. You can place 500-ton heavy equipment at the booth, and you can experience the product from all sides. You even can cut it off. You can start the machine. It's a stone crusher. I can also put material in it, and you see by tumbling the crusher cone, the stones are broken. And I can even switch off gravity. And for engineers and planner, this, or even marketing stuff, and for the owner of these machines, it's fascinating to be able to explore the machines in that depth for maintenance, for handbook, and so on. So this is called the positional tracking. And we have the new data type, real-time 3D. We have got this content from ThyssenKrupp. They are planning the machines directly in 3D, computer-aided design, and we can use it in our software to display further information to it. So a lot of people ask if they are wearing the headset. And they see, for example, the Egypt panorama. Then they ask, is it possible to run here? But it's only a photo. And in a photo, you have one point where the photo was taken, and it's not possible to walk. If you have a panorama video, then you can make a pass along your film in 360 degrees. Then you only can follow this path. You can't leave the path. But there is a new, very new technique. It's called photogrammetry. And you make a number of pictures. In this room, for example, 300, 400 pictures. And the software calculates a 3D model out of it. And that's another time, very, very fascinating. Here I see the world from space. Northern America, there Europe arises. You see on this side, it's night. On this side, it's day. And there are also such little details. If I go very close to it, then you see that the clouds are moving. They are our own layer. So, but photogrammetry, we jump to Berlin. Takes a short time to read all the data. And now I have a combination between panorama photo. You see, it is a photo. But in a normal panorama photo, I can't walk. Here, I'm able to walk. I can use any location and jump to it. And if I move here, I can investigate the scene. I can walk around, and if I lean forward or backward or sidewards, I also have the movement, I feel the movement in this scene. So, this is a next data type. So, photogrammetry. And the last example I'd like to show. Close this. Okay. So we have seen so far the rotational tracking and the positional tracking. Now I've got a new camera. I put this camera on my VR headset. And it's for sure that the whole VR equipment will also get smaller in the future. It will be the same development, for example, as video recorder or television screens. So, now I take this one. Unfortunately, I have no audio. I don't know if you can switch some audio on. So we have the positional tracking, we have the rotational tracking. Now I have a new tracking type. Okay. So, the positional tracking, I can walk. And the rotational tracking. So it's not a very interesting scene. But if I put my hands in front of my head, the hands are recognized. Each finger and each joint of the finger is recognized. I can create objects. And you see that the object first is a wireframe object. And when I release my fingers, then it gets to a solid model. And with this solid model, I can play around. Oops. Okay, I have, like in Minority Report, I have the possibility to use my hands to open the menu, choose another command, and create an object. I have the possibility to build up a little catapult and physical... So, this kind of software is a whole new category of software. Imagine what you can do with it, no matter... So, if you're an architect, for example, an engineer, so... And you can do things which are in reality not possible. For example, tell the gravity to go away. And now I can play with it and can let it fly into the dark universe. And when I want the gravity to get back, I just have to do this gesture. Okay. So, this is really fascinating, but we have some additional... I have two more films to show more tracking types. So you see, virtual reality is all about tracking. The movement of the body is translated into virtual reality. Now it's about walking. Okay. So you see the person walks on one point, and this walking movement is translated into the 3D scene. By that technique, it's possible to walk through large 3D scenarios. It would not be possible to do it, so I can also call it here, body tracking. So here we have seen the positional tracking, and we have one controller for the positional tracking. In that case, we have five positional tracking controller at the hand, at the belly, and at the feet. And with inverse kinematic, you can calculate how the human body has to be arranged, located.
And I've wired up the hand positions to the controllers. You can definitely use some improvements. A fourth on my right. And then I have a fifth tracker at my midsection.
So, and you have to imagine to wear this headset,
now,
see the right picture,
tracker,
and you
really
see yourself from outside your body. Yeah? So it has, VR has a lot to do with philosophy. Because it asks questions about the consciousness. So, eye tracking. So, one could think that eye tracking is rotating the head, but that's the rotational tracking. If I don't move my head, instead just move my eyes, then we have the eye tracking. In this case, this guy has a disease which doesn't let him play piano. But with two cameras in the headset, his pupils are recognized, and he can switch between single tones and accord. So, that is not enough. We have another example. So, what you see here is a Kinect. So, a Kinect can record movement, and this is possible in real time. So, the computer needs no additional time There is no gap between our real time and the time this takes place. It is at a trade fair, at a booth. Intel has made the program, Phase Shift. And
hello, I'm Adonis from Eliator. I'm here in the Intel device.
So at the booth, there is this setup. The people speak into the camera, into the system, and they can choose avatar head.
Developers Forum.
And you see that it's synchronized
and
very
it's
good.
Pretty awesome to use the Phase Shift technology.
This is awesome.
Hi, I'm at Intel's IDF conference, and I'm doing.
So we take our internal track.
Here we see this is the face the guy has chosen. This is the Kinect 3D model. And you have reference points at the mouth, at the chin, at the nose, and at the eyebrows. And it's really astonishing when you match this, the positional tracking. When you match this, it looks.
You get head movement.
Absolutely real.
In terms of rotation and translation, you get eye movement. And of course, you get expressions as well.
So, what does this mean? This means that we can digitalize our environments, we can digitalize ourselves, and we can meet with our avatars in any location. It can be a real location, it can be Mars or the Moon or anywhere on the Earth, but we also can use this technique to do meetings, so an enhancement of normal telecommunication. And I guess that was enough for introduction in VR. You are warmly invited to come to our booth to try it by yourself. And now we would like to.
Yeah. Thank you a lot. Thanks a lot for the beginning now, Marcus. Maybe our. Audience now has some questions. Are there any questions now, currently? No questions? Okay, then I have one. Marcus,
yeah.
All you have shown now, okay, it was very good to see and so on, but maybe some of you and maybe our audience also thinks about, well, it looks really expensive now. And then we would like to show, okay, well, maybe in 20 years or something like that, it is affordable. But how expensive it is in reality now?
So we have three different type, if you make a, we have three different types of virtual reality headsets. This one is a tethered one, Oculus Rift or HTC Vive. There's also a HTC Vive outside of this booth. This costs around 700 euro. 700 euro and a laptop costs 1,500 euros. The desktop PCs start at 750 euro. But there are also mobile versions. The more best known is the Samsung Gear VR. The Samsung Gear VR, you can use a Samsung Galaxy S6, S7, or a Note 5, maybe in some years also a Note 7. the headset costs 80 euro, the smartphone costs from 450. But you can use your own smartphone together with a cardboard. Every one of you has got a cardboard in the greeting bag. If not, we have some more cardboards at our, yeah, there is one. We have some more at our booth.
Yeah.
So
I think I will later on show this cardboard also for our audience here on the IEC general meeting, because some of you maybe have seen it in your bag and do not know exactly what to do with this. But we will show it later on, I think.
Okay. So it will obviously get cheaper when it will become mass production.
Okay.
There are expectations by big companies like Goldman Sachs or Deutsche Bank, who have made VR business reports, that with the number of head-mounted displays, the price will fall. That's obvious.
Okay. Marcus, we have one question here from the audience.
Yeah, I got a question. Is there any idea or any international law what, let's say, sign the virtual reality? Because when I was in this picture, it's real picture, so for me it could be reality as well, and I could not see if I stand for 2 hours working on this ship, for example.
Yeah.
I cannot be 100% sure. Am I now here or am I in virtual reality? Is there something like a law or an idea of doing a standardization to sign that I know that I'm in virtual reality?
It's not yet, but the topic is discussed since over 20 years, because virtual reality was invited in 1966. By the way, that was the year of my birth. And it was invented in 1966. It was in the consumer market at the beginning of the 90s. It was already in gaming halls and in shows in television. But the computer in these days were too weak, and you had a very small field of view and not very complex graphics. So it didn't work. But over the last 20 years, the industry used big caves, back projection, also with positional tracking, and they developed VR further. And all this time, the
science. Yeah.
Social science. So the social science is discussing what it means for the topic of reality. Because the reality is enhanced through the virtual reality. It for sure, a part of our daily work will take place in virtual reality. Also a part of the private life. And the questions which arise are currently discussed, but there are no laws, and I don't think so that there is standardization already. This will raise up in the future, the next year.
We hope
next
so.
Years, yeah.
We hope so. That will take a lot of work for us also. Another question? Here we are.
Okay, let's talk about safety. I mean, as you were mentioning, there's a distance between from 3 centimeters from the glass to your eye. So let's think about, you have this goggles on for a couple of hours, for an hour, 2 or 3 hours every day, every working day. What will it do to our view, to the ability of the eye? I mean, in virtual reality, there's nothing, it's space. But in real reality, there still is something 3 centimeters away from eye. So what do you think?
So I have read an interesting article by a doctor who is specialized for eyes. And he said he sees no reason why this should damage the eye, but we need to experience it over a long time. The difference between real viewing and virtual viewing is that I have to focus the distance. When I have on the goggles, then my eye, the eye is a kind of muzzle. Yeah? So the muzzle is curved and I can focus things which are nearer. But this doctor said we have to wait what this will make with the eye if it's not trained enough. But these days, no danger is in sight yet. I hope it will remain like this.
I hope too. So, any other questions from the audience? There, we have another question.
Hi, thank you. So, you showed the example where the face was morphed onto a virtual face?
Face tracking.
Face tracking, yes, exactly. So is that mainly used for gaming, or are there also like working life applications of this?
No, it is for every kind. The best question would be, for which scenario couldn't I use it? Because we will work and live more and more in virtual reality. And in virtual reality, we have no body in virtual reality, so we need avatars. And if you have seen the keynote from Oculus, Oculus was bought by Facebook, and Mark Zuckerberg last week has shown the next step for the Facebook people is that you have avatars, which are comic-like, but you can choose which emotion, like an emoji, like an emoticon. You can tell your 3D, three-dimensional avatar if he should laugh, should look angry, or should look happy. And I'm convinced that we will, in future, we can scan our body. We can do it already now, and you can print such little figures. And you have your avatar with you when you are in virtual reality, but you can even choose another avatar. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks a lot. So I'm looking around. Any other questions? And again.
thank you very much for your very interesting presentation. You mentioned that this has been developed. It's some time ago that the virtual reality was actually proposed, and now it's come to a point where it's usable. Based on your experience and where you think things are going, what would you suggest, as people talk about the potential problems of being tired after using it for a period of time, what would you suggest might be the causes of that that could be solved? Is it related to frame rate? Is it related to other things that you might be able to comment about?
Yes. So from the technical side, the feeling, so the problem to get sick or to get tired is if your brain gets different informations from the senses. For example, I'm in a panorama and my eyes tell the brain you are standing on one point while I'm going. And the inner ear tells the brain I'm walking, but the eyes don't see this. This causes nausea. And it can be provided if you track more of the movement. That's why with the positional tracking, it's a completely different feeling. So the amount of people who get sick is reduced by a large amount with this. We have a certain resolution on our display. You know it from the 70s, that we had a normal television. Years ago, we had full HD. Now we have 4K. In the meantime, we have 4K on some smartphones. And you have only 30 millimeters, and you have these lenses. And these lenses are like a magnifying glass. That's why you see the pixel structure. The experts think that 16,000 pixels per eye will be enough to see no difference between reality and virtual reality. So it will take some years. Also, to get to track other movement, like the face tracking or like the finger tracking, the more the reality takes place in virtual reality, the more real it feels.
So in effect, you're, I think, suggesting that about 16K
yes.
is sort of the point where the cognitive dissonance is reduced,
yes.
or that your brain eye mechanism says this is real.
Yes, yes, and there are much more techniques. For example, if you have 16,000, 60K resolution, the computer has to calculate it. And at this time, it's not possible. This is too much. But you don't have to calculate 360 degree because you always look at one point. And the eye functions like this, that you see sharp what you have focused. And if you go to the other part, then it is not as sharp as the middle point. And you can simulate this as well by VR technology. And this is also done. I've forgotten the expression. Uh-huh.
Okay. Thanks a lot. 16K. That looks. That sounds really interesting. So, Any other questions? What?
We're up to 8K now, so that's very far away.
Yeah, sure. But maybe it's a shorter way than we think today. Okay, other questions now? If not, thanks a lot, Marcus. We will see you on stage in just a couple of minutes.
Okay.
And now, we have seen... sure. We have seen now many opportunities for virtual reality in different areas of industry, of tourism, and so on. And you will think about now, okay, for standardization, is it just a technical point of view, maybe for safety for us as standardization guys? But if you think about, maybe it's also for our normal standardization work necessary or a potential. So let us look at a small video to show you a bit more about the standardization opportunities for virtual reality. So let the clip go.
In VR, you can look around by simply turning your head. It feels as if you were really there. This is called the feeling of presence. You can activate a VR click, like a mouse click, by placing the crosshair cursor over a button and waiting until the circle is closed. Place the crosshair cursor over the button named Start Conference. The meeting is taking place in Frankfurt, Germany, Boston, USA, and Beijing, China. A 360-degree camera in every meeting room will allow you to join the meeting via VR, just as if you were sitting at the conference table.
So I think we can start now the meeting as a web conference. So I would say let's put on the VR glasses and join the colleagues in Beijing and Boston. Hello to Beijing.
Hello.
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 Hello from Beijing to Frankfurt and to Boston.
Hello to Boston.
Hi.
Hello.
How are you? How's the weather?
Oh, hello Frankfurt. Best wishes from Boston to you.
Hi from Boston.
There are several tools available during the VR meeting. Move the crosshair cursor to the camera button to change between cities. Look at the online standardization button to join work on the document. In your view, open a small window to see the keyboard. Move the crosshair cursor to the camera button to change between cities. Use the 3D button to fade in virtual objects.
So Boston and Beijing, thanks again for all your comments. I would say we see each other in the next meeting, and I will close the meeting. Thank you.
Goodbye.
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 Bye.
So I think we can.
Okay, we are now back on stage. As you have seen, there is quite a possibility to use it also for our standardization life, for example, for meetings. But now, we have seen it now, we have looked around and so on. This was really passive, as virtual reality is not only passive. Let's go a bit more active way. So I need now three persons who want to join us here on stage and there behind us. So are there three guys here in the audience to test it now? Please, feel free to test it. Okay, first one, first volunteer, a second volunteer, and a third one. A third volunteer, we are looking here around. You? Okay, so let's join us. Okay, thanks a lot for joining us. Yeah, she's going there. Okay, now we have three volunteers. Here it's for you. Okay. We have seen it now on the passive way where we can join the meeting. And maybe you say, yeah, it's all fake. You can't do anything with this. It's just a video. But now we will see what happens when we really try it here. So, no.
Unfortunately, no sound here.
Unfortunately, no sound? Okay, no problem. But you will explain it, I think. So, Marcus, it's now up to you.
By placing the crosshair cursor over a button and waiting until the circle is closed.
Okay, the first part is passive part.
So the meeting is taking place in Frankfurt, Germany, Boston, USA, and Beijing, China. A 360-degree camera in every meeting room will allow you to join the meeting via VR, just as if you were sitting at the conference table.
Fine. So I think we can start now the meeting. As a web conference, so I would say let's put on the VR glasses and join the colleagues in Beijing and Boston. Hello to Beijing.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello from Beijing to Frankfurt and to Boston.
So we are
hello
going
to Boston.
Into the
hi.
Part
how
now?
Are you? How's
because
the weather?
Oh, our volunteers have to test it also now, how it looks around.
There are several tools available during the VR meeting. Move the crosshair cursor to the camera button to change between cities. Look at the online standardization button to join work on the document. In your view, open a small window to see the keyboard. Move the crosshair cursor to the camera button to change between cities. Use the 3D button to fade in virtual objects.
And even in the passive part, you can see now
so
you're
Boston
turning it
and
around.
Beijing, thanks again for all your comments. I would say we see each other in the next meeting, and I will close the meeting. Thank you.
Goodbye.
So,
goodbye.
So now the passive part is over, and now we are active.
Yeah, in principle, there are two options.
You will get now the instructions what to do.
Locate.
Move the crosshair cursor to the camera button. Please change to room Beijing and back.
Okay, Pashal, I think that's all we have today.
Yeah. So it was a great day.
Yeah.
So we had really good fun and really good interesting topic to discuss here.
Mm-hmm. So thank you, Frankfurt, Boston from Beijing.
Thank you very much, Frankfurt and Boston.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Really good. It looks like she's a pro.
Yeah, in principle, there are two options. We have the option one, which would locate the portion.
Look at the online standardization button to join work on the document.
And the other option would locate the caution mark on the front wall of the switch here.
It's about the caution note here.
In your view, open a small window to see the keyboard.
The option one, which would locate the caution mark on the
Now that's the mixing up of virtual reality and the reality, because now you can see her hands on the keyboard and she's typing, and this is a reality. And but when you look upwards, there you can see what she has written. So this is the mixed reality now.
Which would locate the caution mark on the side panel of the switch gear.
And this is a new type of online collaboration, because now you can use your own keyboard.
I have an additional idea for the place. Yeah, that's good. I will make an annotation.
Use the 3D button to fade in.
I have an additional idea for the place.
As you can see here, with turning the head,
you can attach annotations to certain areas of the switchgear assembly.
Turn the whole switchgear.
I have an additional idea for the place. Yeah, that's good. I will make an annotation.
This is how now different cities or different meeting rooms.
I have
you're
an
sitting inside,
idea for the
and you
place.
Can give all comments at the same time on one object, which
yeah,
everybody
so
sees.
I will make an annotation.
And everybody looks can see it real time.
Yeah. I have an additional idea for the place. Yeah, that's good. I will make an annotation.
Okay, that was it. So you could see that it was an active part. It was not a fake what we have shown here. Thanks to our volunteer here, and and now we want to look. Well, maybe we have to look to our booth outside at the TC of the Future booth. Let's see what happens there right now. This is the next opportunity for looking.
Do we have more room for interpretation, or do we have to be more precise? Is there anything more necessary?
Maybe you would just tell me.
And then we are on
another
the
volunteer.
Could say, well, these are all the proposed changes. We have all our laptops outside.
So another volunteer for this, and he can now look onto our TC of the Future booth. There's our volunteer working on the booth.
He's right.
And if he,
he
can now turn his head and he can see, there are our online standardization tools on the displays. And he can look 360 degree now.
But what you deleted now at the moment is holding.
He's turning around. There Fabian Schrader is on our booth.
So this was me in the space, and I just said, okay, we'll
and they are working on documents now and explaining something to colleagues or experts from our ICGM. There's somebody coming also to our booth. And this is happening currently right now outside on our booth. So it's not a fake anything, it's live streaming now.
For a week, you're not, and then we are in different, there's a different status where we are. So for me, the document will
okay, so this is not a fake, it's really, you can use it right now.
Because you have already seen it, so you have another
okay,
document.
We have one guy, he's going outside now to the booth. And we will show in some just some seconds they are coming out. Let's look to the monitor if it works.
Okay,
and there he is. So
look at them all. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. there he is. I'm sorry. There he is. Yeah. So you can see here, it is really live now. And perfect. Thanks a lot.
Okay.
So as you can see, this is working already, so we can use it already. So yeah, if you want to try it later on our booth, we are there until Friday, so you can join us and everybody will explain it to you, and you can test also some other things. So for this now, thanks a lot also our volunteer here. So now, maybe Marcus, want to show us some more experience here? Just some wonder too.
If anybody wants to experience virtual reality.
Another volunteer? Anybody here?
Yeah.
You have a question. Okay. Oh, it's also possible to ask questions here.
So we saw in the video that I have to put my glasses on to see the others who also have glasses on. So I didn't see them in reality, only the body, but not the face. How to solve this?
So we already talked about it, about avatars. You will have, there are different approaches. For example, there are headsets where you have a mirror here, a little monitor, and the monitor films your lower part, which is not under the glasses. And you can determine by this movement what the eyes expression are like. This is only one approach. Another thing is that we will have avatars which will use, which are displayed without the headset. Third, you have to mention, it was a little mistake in the movie. It makes sense that in Frankfurt, the guys using the glasses to welcome the other meeting people. But it makes no sense if both sides are wearing glasses. But if you want to talk about an object, a virtual object or a real object, then it makes sense and has even the advantage that, for example, we are talking about standardization of this headset. And I'm looking into the headset right now, but you see the other side. By this conferencing system, you could have the same view than I. So the reality is enhanced by this method. Yeah? And another thing I would like to mention, it maybe it scares you a little bit, but there are two things. There's an operation method to laser the eyes. You know this? So eye laser, sure, 80% of the profi golf players have done this procedure to see better. There is another operation method for blind people, and they get statt Netzhaut,
Retina. Retina, okay, thanks.
instead of a retina, they become a chip implanted. And this is the fifth, so over 5 years, the fifth iteration of this chip. Becomes the resolution becomes better and better. And it's connected with your seeing nerve. So as soon in the future as this second operation is far better than the eyes, and the operation method is same secure as this eye lasering, some people will say, OK, why not? Let's implant virtual reality. Google Glass, in Germany we say it was a shot into the oven. So Google Glass, the project was terminated, and now they have Google Glass 2.0, and it's not for business, not for consumer, it's for B2B. So you know the Google, you know from Microsoft, the HoloLens, goes in the same direction. It will come, but the first project was a little bit weak. Yeah, same as this happens in life. Same as Samsung Note 7. Yes. So there will be a way in the future, but it's not invented right now.
there's still a lot of way to improve. Maybe you can show one another sample
yes.
now with a volunteer. Anybody
yes,
here?
Yes, with a volunteer. That good.
Any volunteer just to have something? Anybody? I'm looking around. No volunteers, really? Yeah, there we have one. Really, thank you.
Okay, okay, so. So I suggest we do a roller coaster.
Okay.
Yeah. Just,
okay,
just
a roller coaster.
Just a second.
Let's see.
So here the roller coaster is this one. There's a new one. Just let me have a look. Ah, yeah, this is much better.
So, and we are looking out at our volunteer and on our monitor.
Just put it up now, your glasses.
What is happening with him?
Let me help. It's a little bit too strong. And now you just have to look at one of the three pictures until the progress bar is filled blue and the journey can start. Can we have some sound?
I have to hold something.
Yay.
Some sound?
Yeah.
Yeah, there it is. So, I told you about the positional tracking. If you look down, you see your cabin. Walk a little bit to the left. You see? You can look down and you even can go outside. Try to go outside. Okay, so not. So, but this positional tracking makes it very real in comparison to a panorama photo.
Okay, there it is.
So,
well, okay, what's happening now?
Yeah, what happens now?
Well,
the gravity. Survived.
Survived this, yeah.
Yeah. Just one other. Keep it on.
Yes.
And you notice that your body temperature raised.
Yes.
Yeah. So, this is the most advanced example. It is an action movie where you can choose your own point of view. So if you lean towards the sign, or look to the right, you see it gets bigger. So your position is tracked. And this scene looks damn realistic on this headset. You can really walk. Yeah? You can choose where to look. And you see the stones which are flying around. They are so real that anybody who is under the glass try to catch the things. The next thing would be that we can interact with the scene. Push the guys away, for example. Okay. This explosion through the car through the air, and you can look inside the car when it's above you. There's someone on the back seat. Thank you. and you even can see his tattoos. So, and this will also, in future, will be next year, it will be possible to experience this in a multiplayer mode. That means one person in Europe and one in Asia or anywhere else can meet there. So, look at this animal, this machine. Okay.
Thanks a lot to our volunteer, and he survived. Okay, the last examples were to explain you, okay, the gaming things and so on, and the virtual experience is really interesting. Before we had the experience for standardization practice, for meetings and so on, and the session now is ending soon, so I just want to sum up a bit what we have seen today. I think virtual reality is a really good opportunity, also for the future. It is going from a special case to mass production, and maybe in the future we will use it. Maybe with some technical improvements, maybe also with some improvements of the law, as we have heard today. But I think it will come. Let's see when it comes. And I hope nobody will fear this and so on, and test it. You can test it right now or the next days on our state, on our booth outside at the TC of the Future booth. And you can also test it via our virtual reality cardboards. It's only the passive part, but when you take out your mobile phones and you look into the Play Store of Android or the Apple Store, you just have to type in 360 and IEC. You will find there an app which is called 360 Degree IEC General Meeting. And there you can find this app and you can download it on your mobile phone. Then you can take out your cardboard, what is in your bag now. I think most of you have it. If you have no cardboard yet, it's also available on our booth. And then you can start doing these things and try the passive video also yourself at home. Maybe you are afraid to do this outside at the booth. You can do it at home and try out what happens there. There's also an instruction in your bag how to use it. Also, this is available at our booth if it's not for you. So, I think this is a real good opportunity, and hopefully we will follow it also as IEC and all the other national committees will follow this technology, and maybe we will use it. Maybe we will also test it in some project groups, how it will work and how this happens, and get some feedback from these project groups. First of all, to the end, I have to thank Marcus Prenas and his team for giving us all these opportunities to see it. Thanks to our audience for the interesting discussions and the good questions. Thanks to all of you. And this was now our session. I will give to Corinna now.
Thank you very much, Carsten. That was a great session and well, a lot of fun too.
Thank you.
And thank you also to Marcus. And I'm pretty sure you have all enjoyed this last session of a very full but very interesting Wednesday. And tomorrow, Thursday, we will continue in this arena and we will start at 9 a.m. again at talking about Industry 4.0 tomorrow morning. So I'm sure it's going to be another exciting session tomorrow. And please come back, join in, and have a great evening here in Frankfurt. Thanks for joining. Bye-bye.
IEC General Meeting 2016. Connecting communities. Reinvent standardization.